Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club. My name is James Sims. I'm the president of the club. We just recently had an election. And as you know, this year is the FCCJ's 70th anniversary. And as a part of our speaker program, we are trying to get representatives of Japanese government, society, and obviously business to come talk about the current state and the future of Japan. And so today, we have the representative, the chief representative, the chairman of the Japan Association of Corporate Executives, Mr. Yoshimitsu Kobayashi. And today, he will be doing a brief overview of the Japanese economy, its outlook, and what Japan needs to do to move the country forward, including issues such as sustainability, energy policy, free trade, labor regulations, as well as environmental issues as we come into the talks that will be coming up in Paris at the end of the year on climate change. And we were talking in the anteroom earlier. His background is in, I think it's radiation physics. And so we were talking about the various research projects that his company, Mitsubishi Chemical Holdings, is doing in terms of trying to reduce the impact on the environment from economic activities. But so anyway, without any further ado, I would like to welcome our guest today, Mr. Yoshimitsu Kobayashi, the chairman of the Japan Association of Corporate Executives. And before I forget, and today is our interpreter, Ms. Takamatsu. Anyway, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the very kind introduction by Sim-san. Also, thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to talk to you in the Foreign Correspondent Club of Japan. As of April 29th, I was assigned as the chairman of Kedai Doyukai, and just 2 months has passed. I would like to today to talk about what I'm going to do together with my members of Kedai Doyukai about our business management and also the proposal for the government policy. This is what I'm going to talk about today, and here you can read that what I'm talking about is the items about the mainly sustainability of the society and also how to handle the corporate management, and also before the question and answer, I would like to talk a little bit about the following items. One is latest Japanese economy, our opinion on fiscal consolidation plan of the government, which comes shorter, tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, and also free trade agreement, labor policy, energy policy of Japan, and environment measures. Let me first give you some explanation about the terminology, Japan version 2.0. Actually, Japan version 2.0 is not a buzzword created by the Japanese media. I myself created this term about 2 months ago. From 1945 to 2015, after the Second World War II, Japan enjoyed a huge economic growth. Although some people say that latest last two decades has lost 20 years. And let us call these 70 years as Japan 1.0 or version 1.0, whatever. I propose that we are now moving toward a new era from 2020, which I call Japan version 2.0. The year of 2020 marks an extremely critical juncture for Japan. We must ensure the success of the Olympic and Paralympic Games. Moreover, Japan has pledged to the international community that it will achieve a primary surplus by fiscal 2020. At the same time, Japan faces a number of problems that require long-term solutions. We must tackle those issues so that we can make sure to move toward sustainable society. Also, as mentioned in the second machine age, or Industry 4.0, we are now coming to the age of cyber-physical space, which is composed of both real economy and cyber economy, big data, AI, 3D printing, etc. In this respect, the coming 5 years from 2015 to 2020 will be a critical time for us to succeed the transition from Japan version 1.0 to 2.0. Now, I would like to share the urgency of this truth. No bright future without revolutionary transformation. Needless to say, we are facing a very broad range of issues. We cannot avoid looking away from inconvenient truths and problems. Particularly, I would like to share out our understanding on the following 3 points. Firstly, let us remember that Japan has accumulated more than 1,000 trillion yen in public debt and now faces the potential risk of fiscal collapse. Japan has made an international pledge to achieve a primary surplus by fiscal 2020. But this is merely a milestone on the way to fiscal reconstruction. The path to debt reduction must be firmly established. Number two, Japan is experiencing declining birth rate and aging of society. Two problems that are common to mature societies throughout the world. The total fertility rate in many developed countries have dipped far below 2 children per woman. My third point is the global agenda. It covers economic disparity and poverty, ethnic and religious conflict, shortages of food and water, the exhaustion of energy and other resources, and also climate change on a global scale. Also, I believe it is important to envision future societies from the perspectives of these global tides of change. These are globalization, IT revolution, and socializations. As I mentioned in the beginning, 2020 marks an extremely critical juncture for Japan. We must ensure the success of the Olympic and the Paralympic Games. Moreover, Japan has pledged to the international community that it will achieve a primary surplus by fiscal 2020. At the same time, Japan requires solutions for pollution, population decline, regional revitalization, sustainability of social security systems, energy and the environment. We cannot allow ourselves to fall behind the global tide or these cutting-edge development. By 2020, we must achieve visible and tangible results to enter the era of Japan version 2.0. It is particularly important to realize that Japan today is standing on the edge of a cliff, not a mere turning point. In developed economies as Japan, US, Europe, etc., GDP growth rate has gradually declined as society matured. Combined with the effects of the rapid growth of emerging countries, the shape of these developed economy in global GDP is receding. GDP is calculated based on factors that can be measured in monetary and economic terms. Thus, it provides an appropriate metric of the satisfaction and happiness that people derive from meeting their material needs. But I feel there are limits to the usefulness and the effectiveness of GDP as a metric concerning people's well-being. We, Kedai Doyokai, are going to discuss on the future society, including these kinds of concepts. Although the most focal points to discuss are, of course, productivity and effectiveness of the economy or business itself. Next one is the drawing of the cyberspace age. A little bit, it's a very fundamental mathematics I used in the high school we learned. Let me consider Japan version 2.0 from another viewpoint or another angle. I think we are now witnessing the dawning of the cyberspace age. In the age of real things, value was measured in progressively smaller unit of weight and traced the shift to lighter and more compact products, from tons to kilogram to grams to milligram and finally to micrograms, like medicine or a pharmaceutical product. We can readily see that in the cyberspace age, information with no weight will be the source of value. That is to say, atom to bit, or bit to atom. These kind of combination will be very critical. 3 months ago, one idea come to me. I refer to this as Z equal A plus BI, where A stands for atom and B for bit. And I stand for internet. I stand for internet or imaginary parts. And at the same time, it means imaginary parts or number. I believe this very elegantly describes the world beyond 2020. Call to mind conjugate complex number that you studied in school, as already said, that multiplying two conjugate complex numbers, A plus BI and A minus BI, yields Z times that Z equal A plus BI times minus BI. This, in turn, is equal to a square minus B square times I square equals squared plus B squared. Object can be measured in terms of size and weight. But what this means is that virtual space with no weight and services can also be counted in terms of size. This is also a little bit complicated three-dimensional drawing. Now, let me explain my philosophy on the corporate management of three or four-dimensional axes. Since 2010, I started to install this concept to Mitsubishi Chemical Holding, and now I could say around 70% become successful, settled inside the employee's mind. Firstly, I will explain very briefly what is the Kaiteki value, or from where the corporate value can be defined. As here depicted, management of economics, management of technology, and management of sustainability, these are very independently controlled and monitored. As you look at the x-axis, this just represent the performance of economy or management, especially return on equity. That kind of capital efficiency is always a very important parameters, but it's always measured monthly or quarterly. And the y-axis, it represents the management of technology or innovation induction. That takes more than decades. And the z-axis, this represents a management of sustainability, which include a reduction of carbon dioxide or CSR type of performances of the company. So if we draw the vector, which come from three-dimensional parameters. This blue vector, this one means just corporate value. Not usually in the market, only ROE or this capital efficiency is always cited as only one parameters to pursue the performance of each company, but I definitely think that for the sustainability of the company, we have to discuss these three-dimensional value of the corporate, including performance of economical systems and also production of the new product to the society, and also we have to take care of the society itself. And also we have to think about the concept of time, because we are now living in the 21st, beginning of the 21st century. What the society requires to the corporate, that kind of things is also very important. And also it's very interesting to know that this way of corporate management of just corresponding to International Integrated Recording Council principle or ISO 26000 and also ESG methodology. As for one of the corporate governance, Keidai Doyukai already raised a proposal for ROE, return on equity. Also, to our recommendation, according to our recommendation, companies should achieve double-digit return on equity, ROE. Also, last year, to tell the truth, that the performance of Mitsubishi Chemical is around 6.4 ROE. There are no question ROE stands as one of the critically important indicator in corporate management. At the same time, it is necessary to take into account such factors as the industry-specific characteristics of each industry, management policies, and capability to communicate with stakeholders. For instance, Amazon company is operating in the red, and its ROE is negative. However, the company is highly valued in the stock market. I presume that many people who are working in bookstores has lost their jobs due to Amazon. But Amazon has emerged as a company capable of meeting the needs of growing number of consumers and products and provide a distribution infrastructure that is now indispensable to society. Innovative product introduced by Apple, such as iPhone and iPad, has brought about social transformation on a scale that would have been impossible to predict 10 years ago. Another issue I wish to present is that we need to break mindset of corporate executives. It is quite possible that the process of breaking through rigid regulations or accelerating the pace of innovation will work to the disadvantages of our own companies or even to the elimination of certain businesses. In such instances, the possibility of corporate executives themselves becoming part of the forces of resistance cannot be denied. However, top management must be prepared to make bold decisions and to act swiftly on cutting-edge development and the tides of global change. Facing an uncertain future, corporate executives frequently find themselves in turmoil and struggling with conflicting forces. But the point is that we must not allow ourselves to become captives of the constructive rigidity that exists in our own mindset. Now, let me talk a little bit about the major topics for Japan economy. Since the Abenomics started in the end of 2012, major improvement have been made, and we are overcoming some of what we call the six tribulations or the seven tribulations. That means we have six or seven handicaps when compared to the other countries. But by the help of monetary easing, this is a first arrow, and also second arrow, fiscal stimulation, especially this depreciation of the Japanese yen contributed a lot to companies' performance as we generate profit from overseas. A view of government and other statistics indicates that the Japanese economy remains on track for a moderate recovery. What is the outlook for the Japanese economy? I expect the horizon to remain bright. We conduct quarterly surveys in Doyukai. In the latest survey this month, out of 589 members from Kedai Doyukai, 43.8% said the real GDP growth for 2015 would be between 1.5% and less than 2.0%. And then 24.6% forecasted somewhere between 1.0% and less than 1.5%. We also asked to identify area of concern for Japanese economy. 53.3% replied with the future of the world economy centered on Europe and the United States. In second place, 52.1% was a declining consumption due to lack of progress in addressing the problem of declining population. As you are aware today, Greek EU issue will be the very strong concern for the world economy. Then come to the fiscal consolidation. On the subject of fiscal consolidation, as I mentioned, Japan has made an international pledge to achieve a primary surplus by fiscal 2020. To maintain the confidence of the markets, it is absolutely essential to meet this goal. On top of that, I believe it is justified to set indicators of progress in reducing the government debt to GDP ratio and asset to GDP ratio. Fiscal year 2018 marks the midway point in the goal for achieving a primary surplus. Shortly, the government will announce the plan, specific goal negotiated with LDP, whether or not to restrain increase of social security expenditures down to 1.5 trillion yen for 3 years. The Japanese government plan looks very optimistic for the future revenues from economic growth, assuming that the 3% nominal and 2% real GDP increase. Also, by 2025, all baby boomers will be above the age of 75. This will further increase spending on health and long-term care afterwards. I consider these to be major risk factors. In the area of trade policy, above all, I am so much pleased to witness remarkable progress in the United States Congress, which add great momentum to the TPP negotiations now facing the final stage. I also hope that the United States and Japan work closely to clear all the remaining bilateral issues and ministerial meeting of the 12 participating countries to be held in a timely manner. and the Keidai Doyokai will appreciate successful negotiations. Also, regarding the Japan-EU-EPA, export and import between the two sides are roughly equal at around 7 trillion yen. On the other hand, tariff payment on Japanese export to the EU comes to about 240 billion yen, which is nearly twice the amount of tariff payment on EU export to Japan. Therefore, I really expect the negotiation to progress toward a greater trade liberation. And a little bit about employment policy. Regarding labor policy, the House of Representatives passed the revised Worker Dispatching Act on the 19th this month. We appreciate this as a significant step forward. The proposed revision of the Labor Standard Act, featuring the introduction of a category of highly specialized professional workers, is before the Diet. Now that the Diet session has been significantly extended to September 27th, I do hope that the bill will pass during the current session. And also, enactment of these revisions will provide both workers and management with more choices, which is a very good thing. However, management must pay attention to avoiding a situation where those who are cautious about the bill's fear. Another question is a monetary resolution system for wrongful or unfair dismissal. A panel of experts is established before the end of this year. I'm watching this progress in a very positive way. Finally, come to the energy policy and the environment. On the subject of this energy policy, let me start with nuclear power. In July 2011, soon after the Great East Japan earthquake, Keidai Doyokai issued a policy proposal that called for reducing dependence on nuclear power. This was followed in March this year by in-depth recommendations featuring three specific proposals. One is restart and operate reactors once safety is confirmed. Second, reduce dependence on nuclear power to a certain level over the medium to long term by decommissioning obsolete reactors and substituting nuclear power with renewable energy and energy conservation. Thirdly, it is unlikely that renewable energy can meet more than 30% of energy needs by 2030, even if the pace of introduction is maximized. Therefore, to achieve about 50% in zero emission power generation, nuclear power will have to continue supplying at least 20% of Japan's power needs. These outline the basic thinking of Keidai Doyokai on this subject. This is a drawing of what we are now thinking. Compared to 2010, before the earthquake, we proposed to reduce dependence on nuclear power to a certain level and dramatically increase renewable energy while reducing the percentage of coal or gas fired. Our proposal is pretty much close to the government proposal. Our proposal was just announced in the end of March, and the government, after just 1 month later, nearly very similar proposal has come from the government. Finally, environment policy. The G7 summit adopted a leader's declaration that introduced a new long-term goal for reducing global greenhouse gas emission by the upper end of 40 to 70% by 2050 compared to 2010 levels. The Japan government proposed reduce greenhouse gas emission for 26% by 2030 based on amounts of 2013. This is a very aggressive target, I think. We request the government to establish an effective international framework with all major emitting countries at COP21 in Paris in December, in order to keep the rise in the average global temperature within 2 degrees centigrade over the super long run, business have to play a central role in implementing innovation. We are asking the government to support R&D for innovation and to promote existing effective technologies, including highly efficient solar generation, storage batteries, LED lighting, insulator materials, and very lightweight materials. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much. And I forgot just one housekeeping note. If you have your cell phone, if you could just please put it on manner mode or turn it off. And anyway, so we'd like to go to questions from the working press. If you have any questions, please state your name and your affiliation, and no speeches.
Martin Kölling with the German Financial Daily Handelsblatt. Basically two questions I would like to ask. One is about the situation in Europe. Everybody is now scratching their heads what this might mean for the future. I would like to understand the position of the Japanese companies, of yourself, what your concerns are regarding the situation in Greece, possible Brexit, and what you fear could be the worst outcome for Japanese companies. This would be my first question. The second question is, you mentioned it a little bit in your speech, the new growth and fiscal consolidation plan of Prime Minister Abe. I would like to understand your position on your evaluation of the progress of Prime Minister Abe on two fronts. One is fiscal reconsolidation. Because in that regard, Prime Minister Abe seems to hesitate to step on to start saving. And you mentioned that. I would like to understand whether you think that this really will lead to a fiscal consolidation. This and can basically reach the goal of turning into the deficit into a positive balance by 2020. The second point is then, of course, the structural reforms, the so-called structural reforms. What reforms do you think have been implemented already? How successful have they been implemented, and what is still lacking in your point of view?
ドイツの金融の新聞でございます。たくさんの質問が、出たわけでございます。一つはギリシャの問題でございますが、日本 の、 企業、またその経済同友会のメンバー、企業たちはこれをどう見てらっしゃるんでしょうか。どのような直接な影響が日本の企業を受けるというふうに思ってらっしゃるんでしょうか。そして最悪のシナリオを考えますと、どういうものを考えられますでしょうか。で、二つ目の質問でございます。これは二部構成になるんでございますが、先ほどそのアベノミクス、安倍首相 の、 その成長戦略、またその財政健全化政策などについて触れたわけなんでございますが、この進捗状況をどう評価されてますでしょうか。具体的に伺いますと、その経済財政再建ということでございますが、あんまりその実際 の、 その歳出カットにおいて安倍政権は積極的ではないというような感じがするんでございますが、本当にその黒字化、2020年までは基礎的財政収支の黒字化というのは達成できると思いますでしょうか。もしその進み具合が良いと思いますと、どのような部分で良い政策を進めているんでしょうか。そしてもう一つでございます、その構造改革についてでございます。これも同じように具体的にどのような政策を安倍政権は実際に実行しているんでしょうか。そしてどのくらいに成功していると思いますでしょうか。あるいはどういうところがまだ不足していると思いますでしょうか。
ギリシャの問題ですけれども、まあ、今日も今どのぐらい株下がってるか分かりませんけど、最初ちょっと見たら500円が450円ぐらい下がってるって中で、まあ、そういう影響は見事に出てるっていうことなんですが、まあ来月の5日に、ギリシャで国民投票があって、どういう結果になるかも、まあ、一部関わることかもしれませんけれども、まあまあ、2つのケースで相当なオーステリティをしっかりやりながら受け入れるか離脱するか、まあ、ただそのインパクトはその経済の力としてギリシャっていうのは、まあ、はっきり言ってかなり小さいのでですね、結果としてはまあ最初、まあ、今日の株も下がり、世界の経済のマーケットにおいてはある程度センシティブに透明になって、まあ、1、2ヶ月したら相当落ち着いてくるのかな。結果としては日本の経済への大きな影響っていうのは、まあ、あんまり考えなくていいのかなっていうのが僕の、あるいはまあ、それは直接ギリシャといろいろな、関係のあるところを除けばですね、一般論としては、むしろポルトガルもイタリアもスペインもだいぶ良くなっている中で、大きな影響は少ないのかなというのが一つですね。それと、まあ、安倍さんの政策、まあ、2012年の暮れから政権を取って、まだ2年半なんですが、まあ、非常にその今まで官僚をかなりそのあまり使いたがらなかった民主党政権から比べると、官僚もあるいは民間有識者と称していろいろな会議体を設けて、その非常に多くの人たちを巻き込んで、もっと言えばそのまあ何とか会議とかいうのは結果としては政治があるいは官がやりたいような方向に持っていくお墨付き的な部分もないわけじゃないんですが、少なくともそういう演出はかなりうまくやって早くやってきたなっていうのはものすごく一般的な印象ですね。 ずっとやっちゃっていいですか。
いや、ちょっと止めていただいていいですか。So, first of all, in regard to your first question about Greece, as you see, there have been some effects on the stock markets. In fact, before I came here, I was watching how stock market prices, and they have fallen to the tune of about 500 or 550 yen or so. And so it's obvious that there is some impact about what is happening regarding what is happening in Greece. As you know, however, next month, on the 5th, there will be a national referendum held in Greece. And of course, everyone will be watching closely to see what the results will be. There are two possible outcomes. One is that they will accept very, very severe, harsh austerity measures, conditions, and stay as part of the EU, or they will as part of the euro, or they will decide to go off on their own. But in any event, when we talk about the impact of what Greece does, I think the Greek economy, and I do not mean to be disrespectful, however, in the world economy, plays a very small part. It is not such a huge economy. But having said this, however, as I mentioned earlier, stock prices, even in Japan, are beginning to fall, and the world markets, economic markets, financial markets, are very sensitive to any changes that happen with Greece. Having said all of this, however, I think within a month or two, regardless of what the outcome of that national referendum might be, I think markets will settle down. And if you're asking about what the impact might be on Japanese companies or the Japanese economy, I think that over time the impact will be fairly small. Of course, there are some companies, some organizations that deal directly with Greece, and they may have some difficult situations. But putting those a few companies aside, I think in general the impact will be fairly small, in part because other countries in Europe, such as Italy and Spain, are seeing an upturn in their economies. Therefore, I do not think the overall impact will be very severe. In regard to your second question, certainly Mr. Abe has been in power for about 2.5 years from the end of 2012, and he has taken a very, very different stance from the previous administration, which was led by the DPJ, the Democratic Party. I took a very strong policy of not working with bureaucrats. They wanted to go on their own. However, the Abe administration has taken a very different tack, and they have not only cooperated with bureaucrats, but they have, in fact, cooperated with the many, many people in the private sector, academics, experts. They have created many different councils, and of course, one could be cynical and say that some of these councils of experts are basically ways to give a brand or a seal of approval to policies that the bureaucrats have thought up. But even if that is so, I think everyone will agree that what Mr. Abe has done has been very, very well done. Even if it is a performance, it has been a performance that has been very well done.
で、次その、財政再建に行く前にですね、その安倍さんというかこの2年半のパフォーマンスをどう考えるかっていうのをちょっとお話したいんですけど、私はその2013年安倍政権が確立して2013年1月9日から8月っていうか6月の骨太を出すまで約1年9ヶ月、経済財政諮問会議っていうところの議員をやってまして、それから去年の9月2014年の9月から今度は産業競争力会議というところの委員をやってまして、つぶさに安倍政権の動きを見れるそういう立場にいたものとして感じるのはですね、いずれにしましても政権を取ってその諮問会議を新たにこう発足させたと、民主党政権ではその諮問会議というのはなかったわけなんですが、その中でもうすかさずまた3月にはですね、みんな TPP っていうのはちょっと無理だろうと、民主党政権の時代ですと安倍さんが向こうアメリカに行く前に大体のイメージとしては TPP 無理だろうっていうのをしっかりとやはりそれを具体的にここまで動かしてきたっていうのは、これは大きな冒険であろうと思いますし、その次の4月には、いわゆる日銀の総裁を黒田さんに変えた、それで今80兆円に余るその金融緩和って言いますかモネタリーイーズングをやった。で僕なんか常識的に思うと、あれだけ逆に言えばもう緩和は一部、黒田さんの前の総裁が、やってた中であまりそんなに緩和をしたって効果があるのかなと一部思ってたんですが、結果としてやっぱりすごい効果があったんですよね。ということで80円が120円まで来たっていう、それによって日本の経済がかなり活性化した、これはやっぱり非常に大きな効果で、それと加えて補正予算を5兆円以上をかましてきたっていう中で非常に経済が具体的に動き出した。ただ経営側ってのは今でも設備投資がまだそれほど増えないっていうのはやっぱりそれはそのぐらい半年はそこでちょっと良くなってできるような経営ではないんで、やっぱり5年10年、100年の経営とは言わないでもですね、5年10年の先で投資していいのかなっていう確認がないとなかなか難しいんで、今そういう季節かもしれませんけれども、そんなのがありますし、もうちょっといいですかね。
どうぞ。
実はその去年の1月、おととしの1月9日に諮問会議に入って、で我々やはり競争力はかなりその先あとで述べます構造改革についても相当アクティブにその始まった時点はこうやってバージョン1の時代ですね。で諮問会議は比較的おとなしいと言われたんですが、僕は唯一やっぱりきちっとやったなっていうのは去年の1月21日の会議から始まった法人税を下げてくれと、で2月21日もまた会議があったんですが、この2回の会議が相当ハイライト ートすべき時であって、まあこれ財務省はもうあの当時全くノーで、安倍さんはかなり前向き、まあ、そんな中で民間も含め我々も相当この法人税っていうのは 20% 台を目指して、まあ最終的にはグローバルには韓国でも中国でも、まあ、シンガポールは 10% 台ですが、まあ、25% ぐらいにしてくれっていうことがかなりラインに乗ってきて、具体的に政治も動いた。で、まあ、今の収入ですと法人税がむしろ1兆円ぐらい増えてるっていうのは法人税のパラドックスって言いますか、下げると法人税は下がるんじゃなくて上がるんだというのが事実具体的になってきているっていうのは、やはりですから TPP と法人税をしっかりやっていただいて、もう当然1の矢2の矢の金融かあの緩和、財政出動、まあ、これはやっぱり見事に初動は良かったなという評価はできるんじゃないかと思います。
ちょっと長すぎます。
Next, before we get into fiscal consolidation, I would like to talk to you about some of the experiences that I have had with the Abe administration. In fact, I'd just like to talk about his past 2.5 years as head of the administration. On January 7th, 2013, I was asked to become part of the CFP, the Council on Economic and Fiscal Policy, and I served on this council for about a year and 9 months, and during that time, there was what is called the big-boned policy, the policy by the government to basically stimulate the economy. Also, separately from that, as of September of 2014, September of last year, I've become a member of the Industrial Competitiveness Council. And as a result of my being a part of these two important councils that are attached to the government, I think I've been able to see what Mr. Abe has been trying to do and some of the results that he has been able to achieve very much up close. And I would like to basically bring your mind memories back to when he first took the reins of power. At the time, the Council on Economic and Fiscal Policy was something that had not been used at all by the DPJ administration, and the first thing he did was revive this council. And as soon as he regained power in March of the following year, he basically tried to revive the TPP negotiations. And this is something that for during the administration of the DPJ, people had thought it would be impossible to move forward with. But as you can see, Mr. Abe has made tremendous progress in moving this forward. And then in April, the following month, he appointed someone very spectacular, Mr. Kuroda, to be the governor of the Bank of Japan. And as a result, he has been able to implement a quantitative monetary easing to the tune of about 80 trillion yen plus. And for me, to be very honest, at that time, I thought quantitative easing would not really be much of an answer because, after all, there had been some kind of easing policies that had been implemented even under the tenure of the previous governor of the Bank of Japan. But I see that Mr. Kuroda's efforts have been very, very successful. You've seen the exchange rate change from 100 yen to the dollar to 120 yen to the dollar. And that currency rate shift has been a tremendous revitalizing force for the Japanese economy. In addition to this, Mr. Abe pushed forth a supplementary budget of 5 trillion yen, which also helped revive the economy. Having said about all of this, however, you can see, however, when we look at individual different companies, we see that CAPEX, the investment in new infrastructure capacity, has not risen that much yet. And that is because although the results for the economy have been very positive for the past 6 months or so, that's not enough for a company to justify making huge investments in the future. They have to be able to predict what the economy will be like 5 years into the future, 10 years into the future. I wouldn't say they have to know what it's going to be 100 years into the future, but at least 5-10 years into the future. They must have some assurance that the economy will keep growing. Having said this, however, last year, you asked about structural reform. As I mentioned, 2 years ago, in January, I became a member of the Council of Economic and Fiscal Policy, and we did talk about structural reform. We were still in the era of version one, Japan version one, and at that time, it was said that this council, although it had been reactivated, was still very quiet and wasn't very accomplishing very, very much. However, in January, we had a meeting on January 21st, and we took up very seriously the issue of raising corporate taxes. And this gained great attention. And the following day, January 22nd, we had another follow-up meeting, again discussing corporate taxes. And I think this was just the highlight of the activities of this council in that, of course, we faced tremendous opposition from the Ministry of Finance. However, Prime Minister Abe was very much looking forward to lowering the corporate tax. Eventually, we would like to see it go down to something in the 20-30% range. We don't expect it to go down as low as Singapore, which is 10%, but at least in the realm of we see in China and South Korea, which is about 25%. But in any event, we see that corporate taxes were able to be decreased. And it's a funny paradox. You would think that if you lowered corporate taxes, then the corporate tax revenues for the government would decrease. But the actual result has been an increase in the corporate tax revenue to the tune of about 1 trillion yen. So what I'm saying is that if Prime Minister Abe continues with his successful efforts to push the TPP forward, if he continues with his attempts to further lower the corporate tax rate, then I think in addition to the first two arrows, you know, monetary easing and fiscal stimulation, we will see even more positive results.
TPP.
TPP とその法人税を今後もしっかりやってればということですね。
それではちょっと構造改革のお話もありましたんで、やはり農協さんを含めてですね、これも結構岩盤の一つだったものを、まだ法律的にはまだ完全に確立されてないんですが、しっかりとこれもやったと。で、医療改革、医療介護も含めて、今岡山大学なんかが一つの例になってますが、非営利のその医療法人っていうのも、もう大体こう目処がついてきた。あるいはグレーゾーンで、自己採血なんていう、自分でその血を取って検査をするっていう意味で、かつてはお医者さんとか看護婦さんがいないとダメだっていうような、一つの例なんですが、こういうグレーゾーンもかなり具体的に前に出てきた。でマイナンバー制度についてかなりその効率よく、やはり、税金の徴収含めてですね、まずとにかくそういう IT 化っていうか、それは医療であろうが全てにおいて IT 化が遅れている日本をかなり具体的にこう変えていこうというあたりは見事にやはりきちっと進めているということが言えるんじゃないかと思います。
You also asked about structural reform, but you see what has happened with Prime Minister Abe and the Japan Agricultural Association, JA. This area was considered to be one of the bedrock regulations area that were very, very difficult to change. And although the legal changes have not yet been put into new laws, etc., still the fundamental reforms have already taken place, and he's made great progress in this area. Also, if we look at the medical field, we look at nursing care, we see, for example, that evidenced by Okayama University, there is more and more progress on having non-profit organizations become involved in this field. There's also another field in medical care called the gray zone area, which has to do with, for example, allowing private individuals to, or other individuals who are not licensed doctors and nurses, to take blood samples to do simple tests. In other words, he has been able to change much of the regulations in this area in very specific ways as well. Also, the My Number policy, which includes also tax collections and also other areas of medical care, we are seeing that an area in which Japan was very much behind the rest of the world in terms of using more and more IT or technology. He is taking very, very positive steps to try to allow Japan to catch up.
私の会社の、子会社の、その田辺三菱製薬っていうのは、今非常に困ってるのは、そのジェネリックがかつては 30% ぐらいだったんですよね、2、3年前。今は40数パーセントになったんですが、アメリカが 90%、ヨーロッパが70から80ということで、とにかくそれに早く合わせろと。そうすると1兆円ぐらいの医療費が浮いてくるというところがありまして、ジェネリックを今議論してるんですが、2018年、2020年あたりに早く 80% にするというような、そういう改革もですね、そのファーマシューティカルの会社にとっては困ったものなんですが、非常にこうガンガンやってると。ちょっと 2,3 年前が30何パーが、もう今や50に近くなり80を目指すと。で、日本の製薬会社は新規 創薬というのはもちろん難しい中で、そういう長期収載品というんですか、ジェネリックに対抗する、まあ、特許切れだけどかなり儲けてたというものがみんな儲けられなくなって、もう国内の事業が惨憺たる状況にあるというところまで一部追い込んでいるというのは、これはやっぱり僕なんかは、あまりプライベート画で飲水はできないんで文句は言えなくて黙ってるわけですが、そのぐらいやっぱりガンガンやってるっていうのは間違いないですね。
Also, if I could give you some specific examples, one of our subsidiaries, which is called Tanabe Mitsubishi Pharmaceuticals, they are looking at generic medicines. And two or three years ago, there were only about 30% of generic medications that were in Japan. However, now the figures are going up to about 40%. However, that is still a very, very low number in comparison to the United States, where about 90% of the medications, the medicines available are generics, and in Europe the numbers go from 70 to about 80%. The generics, introducing more generics into Japan, is being seriously discussed and debated within the government. We're hoping that eventually by 2018 or at the latest by 2020 we will be able to increase the percentage of generics being used in Japan from the current 40% to about 80%. These are the kinds of regulatory reforms that Mr. Abe is very much promoting. This is something that is very positive not only for pharmaceutical companies, but for the country in general. By having this tremendous change, you'll be able to have much more money is freed up for companies to invest in new innovative medications. As you know, generics have a positive and a negative effect. One is that it makes medications cheaper for the general population, but also it means that companies which had patents see their patents run out, and all of these very profitable patents, patented medications, now no longer produce money. This is something, therefore, that companies are facing tremendous difficulties, and this is a situation that needs to be resolved because of corporate governance issues. Because I, as I said, myself, I'm involved in a pharmaceutical company because it's one of our subsidiaries. I can't speak up too much about this. Still, I am very, very pleased with the fact that Mr. Abe is moving forward with this kind of regulatory reform as well.
じゃあ最後に財政再建 その可能性っていうか どう考えるかっていうんですが、まあ、先ほどここの13ページでも簡単に述べましたけれども、もともと2020年に対して経済成長率がまあスタンダードっていうか普通ですとその 2% ノミナルで 1% リアル GDP インクリスっていうのを仮定したら16.4 兆円ぐらいまだデフィシットが出るんですね。で 3% 名目で 2% 実質 GDP のインクリスってんで 9.4% 9.6 兆円のそれでもまだ赤が出る、そういうまず状況があります。
So in regard to my views as to whether Mr. Abe will be successful in achieving fiscal consolidation, in other words, producing a surplus in the primary balance in 2020, as I referred to in my slide on page 13, the original goal was 2020. However, when we look at the economic growth rate predictions, standard predictions would be that you would have a nominal growth rate of 2%, a real growth rate of 1%. That would still mean that by 2020, we would have a 16.4 trillion yen deficit in the primary balance. If we were to be more optimistic and predict a nominal growth rate of 3% and a real growth rate of 2%, we would still be producing a deficit of 9.6 trillion yen.
それで、まあ、3の2を仮定して、なおかつ、その、だいぶ税収が、その、これ、タックスエラスティシティっていうんですかね、税制弾性率ってやつが、1.0 を、まあ、財務省は仮定してるんだけど、その、まあ、経済財政諮問会議が 1.2 とか 1.3 もありえるだろうというのをこう仮定すると、それでまた4兆円か5兆円出てくる。ですから3と2でなおかつ税制弾性率がちょっと上げて、そこで税収っていうのは 9.6 の中で4ぐらいはいいだろうと。それでよってあと 5.5 から6兆円のその、まあ、いずるを制するっていうか、その 社会保障等々を削ろうと、こういうのが大体の政府の考え。
So, the fundamental policy of the government at present is that it is hoping for the optimistic view to be realized. In other words, a nominal growth rate of 3% and a real growth rate of 2%. And in addition to this, there's another concept called tax elasticity. This is predicted to be 1.0%. That's the Minister of Finance's theoretical figure, and whereas the Council of Economic and Fiscal Policy is thinking more flexibly by 1.2, 1.3. But in any event, going back again, we have this positive growth rate of 3.3% nominal and 2% real, and on top of that, we have this tax elasticity, which means that the tax revenues will go up. So I mentioned earlier that we would have, according to the positive growth scenario, a 9.6 trillion yen deficit. But with this tax elasticity concept coming into play, that would account for an increase of tax revenues by about 4 trillion yen. So the difference that remains is that 5.5 trillion yen, 5.6 trillion yen is still the deficit that would remain in the primary balance in 2020. How to deal with that? This is where the administration will have to make specific decisions about how much and where to cut Social Security benefits.
おそらく明日以降何らかの形で収まるんでしょうけど、自民党は、やっぱり毎年とりあえず2018年までは、社会保障費を5000億ぐらいに抑えて 1.5兆円ぐらいに抑えるという方向を出せば、そのぐらいはなんとか、なるだろうということで、極めて明確にそのいつまでにどれだけ削るって言ってるのは、2018年 GDP 比 1% っていう、これだけは持って社会保障費も5000億に抑えようというのを書き込めば、そこそこ2020年プライマリーバランスゼロサープラスということは不可能ではないと、こう考えてます。
Of course, probably after tomorrow, there will be more specific announcements from various parties, and we'll be able to see the numbers more clearly. But what we are hearing is that the LDP has made a decision, or is more or less formalizing a decision, trying to hold down security benefits, social security expenditures, to about 500 billion yen per year. That means from this year to 2018, that would be 3 years, so it's a 1.5 trillion yen savings. And if that can be achieved, I think eventually we will be able to somehow reach this final 2020 target. In other words, the only specific target, midterm target that has actually been elucidated by the government is 2018, 1% of GDP. So again, I go back to this LDP idea that if they can hold down social security expenditures to about 500 billion yen per year, then I believe that somehow it will be possible by 2020 to achieve at least a zero deficit for the primary balance by 2020.
Sorry to follow up on that after going through all the fiscal reform issues, but one of the assumptions is that you would have a 2% real growth, and you said that was actually, I guess, looks very optimistic. So, I mean, how do you evaluate that 2% target?
細かくいろいろご説明していただいたのでございますが、その3、2のお話でございますが、実質成長率 2% というのは、どちらかと言いますと、その標準的なその見通しというより少しプラス前向きな楽観的なということだと思うのでございますが、この数字、この見通しについてどう思いますでしょうか。
先ほどの同友会のこれ見ますと、今年の GDP を 1.5 から2って予測しているのがメインというか一番のプレドミナントな人たちがこのぐらい予測をリアルでしてますから、この調子でずっといけば確かに2とか名目3というのは不可能ではないんですが、この2015年というのは先ほどのやっぱり為替円が80円から120円になって非常に元気が出てきた日本の この状況の中で今後これがサステナブルにこう持続的にっていうところを本気でできるのかっていうのはもう そういう意味で極めてオプティミスティックだと僕は考えています。
So if we look at the slides that I presented earlier, you see that we did conduct these quarterly surveys of our members. The Doyukai conducted a quarterly survey of its members. And according to the latest results of out of our members, the majority felt that the GDP growth rate would be 1.5 to 2%. And that's for, excuse me, the real growth rate. And if we are able to sustain this level of optimism, then I think that a 2% real growth rate and a nominal growth rate of 3% certainly is not impossible to imagine. Having said this, however, as I mentioned, in 2015 we saw some special special circumstances. The yen rate went up, excuse me, from 80 yen to the dollar to 120 yen to the dollar. I'm sorry, the yen fell that much, which of course was a huge stimulating factor for the revitalizing the Japanese economy. But the big question remains: is this revitalization, this very great energetic aspect of the Japanese economy, something that is sustainable? Is that 2% figure sustainable? That is a question, and that's why I refer to this prediction as being a rather optimistic one.
この日本は今トリプルベネフィットというかトリプルメリットを享受していて、為替と金利がもう全然ゼロに近いコンマナンバーっていうぐらいの中と、やっぱり原油がその110ドルから、まあ、40ドルから60ドルまで戻してますが、この原油安、これが本当にもう為替はこの辺で、うっかりするとギリシャの問題もあると円高に動くでしょうし、アメリカの金利がいつ上がるか次第ではまた若干225円ぐらいいって、その為替安の部分もエンジョイできる部分も出てくるかもしれませんけど、原油とてもこれ以上は下がらないでしょうし、為替もフラットであれば、まあ、なかなかそのサステナブルにいくかどうかっていうのは、やっぱり非常に そこはなかなか5年のスパンで議論はできないなというのが僕の感じです。
As you know, Japan has been blessed with what we call the three benefits or triple positive factors. One is, as I mentioned, the currency rate. Secondly is that interest rates are incredibly low. Third is that crude oil prices have fallen tremendously. It used to be to $110 per barrel, and now we're seeing levels of about $40 to $60 per barrel. Having said this, however, is this again sustainable? Currency rates, we are seeing that they're because of different things that are occurring in world events. There may be a tend toward the rise in the value of the yen. Of course, having said this, however, U.S. interest rates may start to rise. I got understood. 米国の金利 is going to go rise by the end of the year and later in the year. And as a result, we might see rates of currency exchange rates of maybe 125 yen to the dollar. But generally, I think they're going to basically remain flat. And I don't think that crude oil prices are going to move or change that much more in the future. What I'm saying is that we've been blessed by these triple factors, very positive factors, but we don't see tremendous changes along those lines in the future, at least immediately on the horizon. So whether this growth is going to be sustainable or not, I cannot really talk with confidence about when I look 5 years into the future.
Sorry, and then just to follow up, I mean, you had a very, I guess, positive overall evaluation of Abe's macroeconomic policies. But what about areas that you think need to be done that haven't been tackled or may not be tackled because of resistance from, I guess, special interests and also like the Zoku and the LDP?
はい、今までそのアベノミクス、マクロ経済政策が非常に成功しているということをいろいろご説明いただいたんでございますが、それでもやはりその、経済政策など、についてあるいは改革についてまだ成功してない分野というのはどういうところにあると思いますでしょうか。例えば抵抗勢力、利権団体あるいはその、族議員、など その影響力があって成功してないようなあるいは苦戦している分野というのはどこかありますでしょうか。
まあ、サイバーセキュリティなんかの問題がありますんで、そのマイナンバーっていうのはどのくらいまで 今思っていることが進められるかというのが一つありますね。それとやはり、まあ、抵抗勢力というよりはやっぱり地方のリバイタライゼーションというか地方創生って言ってるんですけどね、地方についてはやはりまあ同州制っていうかそのもう少し効率よくこう再リオーガナイゼーションが必要な部分がやっぱりまあこのぐらいで幸せであればいいやっていうような部分のメンタリティをどうぶっ壊していくかっていうのと、やっぱりあの医者の開業医の世界っていうあたりはまだ今後の一つの課題ではないかと。
I think there are several areas in which he does have some work left for him to try to resolve. One is that we are dealing in an age where cybersecurity is a very, very critical and a concern. Because cybersecurity is a very, very pressing issue for many people, although he has plans to bring IT into the Japanese society and go forward with this my number idea, how far will he be able to actually proceed? That is one question mark that I have for him. One is that you refer to forces of resistance or private interest groups, but special interest groups. But I think one more pressing issue is this idea of revitalizing regional areas. In other words, how to sort of change the mindset. Many people are sort of satisfied with just how things are, but I think some serious fundamental issues about reorganizing, for example, structures and organizations, institutions within regional areas is something that needs to be tackled. And also, the third area that I think remains a problem is how to deal with doctors, not doctors who work for major hospitals, but private doctors who have their own private practices, how they might resist some of the regulatory reforms in the medical sector that Mr. Abe wants to proceed forward with.
Okay. Oh, Anthony.
Anthony Rowley, Singapore Business Times. How far do you think the shift of Japanese production offshore has impacted the fiscal position in recent years? What has been the net effect? Obviously, some taxes lost, some continues to come back onshore, but what is your overall assessment of the impact of the offshoring of Japanese production?
シンガポールビジネスタイムズでございます、まあ、多くの、 日本企業が生産拠点を海外に移しているわけでございますが、これは全体的にその日本の経済にどのような影響を与えていると思いますでしょうか。もちろん一部の税収はなくなっているんですけど、一部の税収が、まあ得ているということも言われるんでございますが、全体的に見ますとどのような影響が出ていると思いますでしょうか。
非常にその、まあ、ミクロとマクロを言い出すとなかなか難しい質問だと思うんですが、その、まあ、為替ウォンと比べて、あるいはドルと比べて非常に80円70円になった、まあ、言ってみれば日本のコンシューマーエレクトロニクスが2000年から、まあ、2005年ぐらいまでは相当強かったんですが、まあ僕はその円高の影響でシャープにしても、まあ、ソニーにしてもパナソニックにしても大変なその一部敗北を喫したってのは言い訳でなく僕は為替の影響だって常に言い続けてるんですが、まあ一回あそこまで弱ってしまうとシャープは今こんなに苦しみをしている。少なくとも液晶を世界で初めてクリエイトしてシェアが70、80あったものがあそこまでやられてしまったってのはもう為替以外の何者でもないと思ってます。ちょっと順番に喋りますが、
So, if I start talking about this from both a microeconomic and a macroeconomic point of view, it's very, very difficult to answer, but I'd like to touch upon various issues in both areas, both macroeconomics and microeconomics point of view. I think, first of all, I'd like to talk about currency exchange rates, the fact that you see the dollar-won exchange rate 80 to, or 70 yen to the dollar. I would like to point out that when we look at the Japanese consumer electronics industry, they were extremely strong in the world from the period from about 2000 to 2005. Sometimes companies in these fields, such as Sharp, Panasonic, and Sony, justify the difficulties that they've had in their business because of the currency exchange rate fluctuations. But I have long taken a stance that these are not simply excuses that they're making. Their troubles are truly based in great part on these currency exchange fluctuations. When we consider a company such as Sharp, which was first in the world promoting LCDs, liquid crystal displays, and they were so powerful and had great technology and had 70 or 80% market share in the world, and now you see that they're on the verge of collapse. This is obviously and only due to the currency exchange fluctuations.
でまあ、そのくらい少なくとも為替の影響は大きいというのをベースに考えますと、まあ、ソニーもほとんどの部分を海外にこうで全てドルベースでこうものを考えるようなそういうシフトをしてで鉄もほとんど海外展開化学でさえ、4、5年前までは 30%、20数%が海外の売上高比率だったのが今やかなり30、40に近づいてきている。で、いわゆる機械関係ですと 80%、90% が海外。自動車も、もううっかりすると60から70まで海外に行ってしまった。で、これはもう明らかに相対的な円安、円高だったろうと、こう思いますね。
And when we look at Sony, as a result of these currency exchange fluctuations and the high dollar effects, they have shifted a great deal of their production facilities abroad. In the steel producing sector, most of the production has gone abroad. In the chemical sector in which I belong, it used to be that a few years ago, about 20% to 30% of our sales were from abroad. Now the standard industry figure is about 30 to 40%. If we look at the mechanical equipment, machinery sector, again, production facilities are about 80 or 90% shifted abroad. In the automobile sector, 60 to 70% abroad. When we look at all of these different industries and all of these huge percentages of production facilities being taken abroad, we see that the biggest factor for this shift is because of the high dollar.
そういう意味では、かなりその所得収支っていうかディビデンドが海外から入ってくる。それで95% まではノータックスっていう日本の法律があるってことで、そちらの方で所得収支を相当上げて、貿易収支は赤字なんですが経常収支は黒字になってるっていう部分はあります。
In that sense, when we look at income, revenues, income, some balance of payments. When we look at, for example, the dividends that come from abroad, 90% of the dividends are non-taxable. So what that means is that when we look at balance of trade, the effects, a negative balance of trade in terms of products. But the current account surplus is a surplus because, in other words, we're getting financial revenues from abroad.
そういう意味で、円安になってもかなりその換算益っていうか、円とドルの換算益が単純に言えば80億儲かったのが海外で儲かったのが120億儲かったことになりますね。
In other words, what that means is that when we convert yen to dollars, we're seeing a tremendous benefit for Japan because of the currency exchange rates. In other words, if it used to be that before the currency exchange rates changed, when it was 80 yen to the dollar, we would have, for example, 800 billion yen in revenues from abroad. That 800 billion yen in revenues is now 8 billion yen in revenues from abroad is now 12 billion yen in revenues from abroad.
で、これは帳簿上すごく儲かったように見えるんだけど、結局また海外の再投資に使えますから、実質的に日本にとって、日本の政府にとっては先ほどの貿易収支は赤字なんだけれども、向こうで稼いだ金の そのまあ証券なりそういう株式もありますけれども配当金という収入等々で潤うんだけど、その連結決算の帳簿上のお金が直接日本を潤しているってことはない。
ではない。
ない。
ではないですね。はい。So again, because of the currency exchange fluctuations, we're seeing a profit at least on the balance books. On the books, but most of these profits, however, are reinvested into the facilities abroad. And so when we look at the overall benefits for the Japanese government, Japanese coffers, as I mentioned earlier, the trade balance is in the red for Japan. I mentioned earlier because of different investments held in different papers, stocks, and all the dividends. Again, if we just look at the consolidated accounts, then the current account for Japan and other nations, Japan is producing a surplus. But again, these are just simply on the books. They're for the consolidated accounts. And as a result, the fundamental positive benefits for the Japanese economy are not positive. There are no positive effects.
で結局こうやって円安になってますから、あの科学とか鉄みたいにその一つの投資が1000億とか極めてその装置にこうお金をかけるものはもう戻ってこれませんけど、組み立て産業、例えばマシナリーとか自動車、これはもうだいぶ兆候としてこう戻ってきてバランスがこうだんだん取れてくるでしょうし、まあ、一つ言いたいのは政府ってのは単体損益しか考えない、日本国のことしか考えない。だけど企業はどこに本社があったって、どこに工場があったって連結で見ますから、あのプリンシップルに言えばもう全然その行動は違うんだということだけは事実。
So if the yen continues to fall, we are seeing that there are different trends in different industries. For example, if we look at the chemical industry or we look at the steel industry, the investments that must be made into infrastructure are on the order of 100 billion yen. And that's a huge investment, and that, you know, you really can't take back and bring back to Japan. However, in other areas such as that basically do assembly work, you know, there are many, many components to the final product, such as the machinery industry and the automobile industry, we are beginning to see some production shift back, come back to Japan. There is that kind of a trend that we are seeing. But what I'm trying to get at overall is that the way that the governments look at the balance of trade or current accounts or in the way that companies look at their financial statements are very, very fundamentally different, because governments only look for the results for a single year for single industries or single areas, whereas companies don't really care where a production facility might be, where retail sales might be. They look at the consolidated accounts. They don't care where things are actually located. So it's a different way of looking at the world and the economies.
Okay. Oh, this gentleman over here.
Ich bin ein freelance journalist from Germany. I would like to change the pace on the subject a little bit. You mentioned breaking the corporate mindset as one of the things on that you would like to see happen. What kind of mindset do you want to prevail over the current one? And is there anyone, any executive, any corporation that exemplifies that mindset in your mind?
はい、ドイツのフリーのものでございます。ちょっと視点を変えたいと思うのでございます。先ほどプレゼンテーションの中でその企業のトップ の、まあ、役員 の、 その考え方マインドセットでございますを変えたい、あるいはその、まあ、壊したいということだったのでございますが、まあ、今どういうような考えを持っている人たちが多いんでしょうか。そしてどういうような考え方を持ってもらいたいんでしょうか。そしてそれを実際の、まあ、名前を出していただければ、こういうような企業になってもらえて、こういうような企業のリーダーが私が、その求めているものであるというふうにご指摘いただけますでしょうか。
まあ、日本っていうのはその各インダストリーがものすごいまだ無駄な競争をやって、小さい会社がいっぱいあるんですよね。だから自動車でさえ8つも10個もあって、 ケミカルに至っては2万かそこらぐらいのケミカルの会社があって、まあ、大きなスティール会社でもまあだいぶ2社3社 金融もある程度コンソリをしてきてますが、まあ、日本人っていうのはその文化的に農業でも小さい土地でオラが飯はうまいって言って、まあ、ちっちゃいところを耕してものすごく効率性が悪い、インダストリーもまあ そこそこ儲かりゃいいって、だから ROE 10パーどころか、まあ、黒字でやればいいだろうっていう、そういうことで、まあ、村の社会っていうか、そのまあそこそこみんなが幸せであればいいではないかと、グローバルに戦うためにそこまでする必要の感性がなかったっていうか、まあ、そういうことで非常に全体的に見れば結果としては今のところ GDP はまだ成長してんだけど、個別に見たらまだまだ無駄なことばっかりやっている、だけどそれでもいいんだというこのマインドセットをトラクター農業って言いますけど、もっとでかい農地で効率の良い、あるいは小さな化学会社なり、まあこれも部品がありますけど、もっと効率の良い大きなものに集約していくっていう心、あるいは地方で言えば町長、まあ、あるいは 県がいっぱいあるんだけど道州制なんていうと俺は県の知事じゃなくなっちゃうなみたいな心を、こういうのを潰して全体としてやっぱりいい方向に持っていくっていうマインドセットがまだ日本の経営者なりポリティシャンに多いんじゃないかなって気がしますね。
I think that when we look at any sector in Japan, any industrial sector in Japan, I think there is a lot of wasted energy that we see because small companies, many numerous companies are competing against each other, and that kind of competition is really wasteful. It should be more consolidated, and Japanese companies should, I believe, compete on the global stage. For example, even if we say, look at the automobile sector, which is considered to be fairly consolidated, we still see maybe 10 large automobile companies. When we look at my own sector, the chemical industry, we have about 20,000 small companies competing fiercely against each other. And we look at the big steel companies, there's still two or three. The financial sector has seen much more industry consolidation, but still there seems to be this fundamental mindset, this tradition in Japan that people like to work on in small groups, on small things. For example, if we look at Japanese agriculture, instead of being very practical and pragmatic and having huge tracts of farmland and being very, very efficient, still people value farmers who just are nurturing a special kind of rice just in a very small field. And people are very, very proud of that, the unique rice that is produced in that very, very small field. This, I guess, comes from this village mentality that has long been in Japan. I mentioned earlier that I think industry should aim for double-digit ROE figures, like 10% or more. Yet a lot of industry people, even corporate executives, are satisfied with less than that if they say, it's okay as long as we are still in the black. We don't have to have huge ROE figures. There's no reason that we all have to compete in the global markets as long as we can basically, you know, manage to all survive. And all be more or less happy, then I think that's fine enough. And this fundamental idea, this way of thinking, is I think something that needs to be changed. If we look at agriculture, I think we need to be able to consolidate agricultural land into huge tracts of land and be more efficient with farming. If we look at, for example, manufacturers of specific components, pieces of equipment for larger pieces of equipment, making small tools, etc. Now, I think that, and I know that this will, because the level of quality of products that are produced by many of these small companies are very, very high, I know that I will receive criticism for mentioning this, but I think they should also be integrated into larger entities so that they can compete on the global stage. However, this kind of thinking you see not only among people in agriculture, not only among people in different industries, but also among politicians. I mentioned earlier about the problem of regional revitalization. If you look at all of the politicians who work at different levels of government organizations, you see that they do not want to lose their jobs. Even if we talk about the Doshusei, which is trying to bring in the sort of state system, consolidating many prefectures into very large blocks, regional blocks, many governors will stand up and say, I will lose my job, I don't want to lose my governorship, I'm against this. In other words, when we look at every sector, we still have many, many people, the majority of people still having this traditional mindset, and very few examples of this kind of mindset I would like to see.
Okay. Thank you. Just a quick follow-up on the point where manufacturing, some of it's coming back, and part of that is due to, I guess, the much weaker yen. What role does electricity price play in that? I mean, there's been a lot of consternation over the rise in electricity prices, but to me, it from what I understand, for the corporates, it's usually not that big of an issue unless you're like making aluminum.
先ほどその、まあ、製造業であっても自動車の産業において、あるいはその、すみません、機械産業におきましては、まあ、日本にその生産施設を戻し始めている、まあ、そういうのトレンドがあるというふうにおっしゃったんでございますが、そういう経営判断をするときに、その電力、電気のその価格はどのぐらい大きな影響を与えるんでしょうか。
なるほど。これも定量的にはなかなか難しいんですけど、今そのもう値段が18円パーキロワットアワーどころかもっと上がってるような中で、結局アメリカより3倍高くて、韓国よりは 2.5 倍ぐらい高いっていうのは基本的にはあんまり大きく変わってないと思うんですよね。原油が下がってもただまあ円安原油安ってことで、そのエネルギー多消費型でないところはそこの電力コストの占める割合っていうのが、まあ 30%40% ぐらいですと、むしろ技術力で十分カバーできるという見方をすれば相当戻れると。ただエネルギー多消費型の鉄鋼とかその石油化学産業っていうのはもう二度と今後新しい日本での展開、要するに今までメンテをして従来あるコンビナートの一部は当然より効率よくができるけど戻ってくるってことはありえない。だからまあ原子力がまた再スタートして、この原子力のコストを見積もるっていうのはものすごく難しい。リサイクルなりまあプルトニウムの再利用なんかのコストを考えて、あるいは将来のウランの廃ウランをどうするかなんていうところにコストを考えると難しいと思うんですが、まあ、いずれにしても気分として原子力が動くと相当電力が安くなるということであればですね、まだまだ十分戻ってくる可能性はあるんじゃないかと思います。
So, it's very, very difficult to comment, to respond to this from a qualitative point of view. I can say, however, that in regard to, excuse me, from a quantitative point of view, but certainly in terms of the kilowatt hour price of electricity, it's about 18 yen at present, and the numbers are actually rising. This is three times the price of the United States, 2.5 times the price in South Korea. So again, even though crude oil prices have fallen so drastically, we have not seen a corresponding a huge decrease in the price of electricity. And it really depends on what industry you're in, how much you depend on electricity. If you are in an industry that does not depend so much on electricity, then you will be seeing these trends where these companies move their production facilities back to Japan. However, for example, in the steel industry or maybe the petrochemical industry, where again, electricity costs are a very, very prominent factor, then I think probably in the foreseeable future, you will not see a huge move, shift of those production facilities abroad and moving back to Japan. Of course, we know that there is one positive factor in terms of electricity prices on the horizon, which is that the nuclear power plants are going to be in part restarted. And of course, we know, however, that it's going to be very, very difficult to produce a calculation as to what electricity prices should be once nuclear power plants start again, because the previous way of calculating electricity produced by nuclear power plants obviously no longer holds. We have to think about the costs of dealing with nuclear waste. We have to think about the plutonium recycling costs. All of these have to come into play. But still, even though we do not know the final calculations when the nuclear power plants restart, at least psychologically, the fact that nuclear power plants restarting might produce a lower electricity price is a positive aspect for the Japanese.Economy.
Okay, well, thank you very much. We've actually, seems like we've covered an enormous amount of areas. And thank you again, Takamatsu-san, for some very long interpretation. Anyway, as is our usual custom, we would like to give our guest speaker today an honorary membership to the club. And hopefully, we will see you in the club at some point again. And maybe we can get an update in another year or so in terms of how. you know, Abenomics is going. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.